Yes, the third core belief system is kingdom rights for every citizen. Yes, every citizen running under the government of Jesus Christ has got kingdom rights. And it's specific to note here that it was spelled out in the Bible. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You see, this singular thing was what King David spelled out to us in one of the most illustrious psalms that he wrote. Psalm 23, he talked about the rights that we enjoy as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And we'll just go through it. The Lord is my shepherd. Basically, he talked about the right for guidance and protection. I shall not want. He talked about the right to provision. He made me lie down in green pasture. He talked about the right to rest in a place of prosperity, in a place, in a fertile ground. He leads me beside the still waters. You see, the hallmark of the gospel is still there, the leadership of God. He leads me. Yes, beside the still waters. Yes, you have a right to be led in a place that's calm and serene. Yes, that's where we are. That's where we are right now. He restores my soul. That's your right to restoration of your spirit, body, and your mind. Yes. Restoration. The hallmark of the gospel is a reconciliation. Restoration. It's rebuild. It's repair. Restore. Whatever has been lost, everything is restored. You have a right to have everything restored. He leads me in the path of righteousness. You see the hallmark of the gospel coming up again, the leadership of God. But now he says something incredible, the path of righteousness. The path of righteousness is a path of glorification. The Bible says righteousness exalts a nation and sin is a reproach to the people. So the path of righteousness is the path that Jesus Christ walked on. It's the path that you will see and hear at all time, per time, the things that God is doing and saying. Yes. The path of righteousness is the path lived preaching this gospel of the kingdom. Yes. Why? Because of his name Jesus, for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. Yes, you have the right to a rare dimension of courage. Yes, because you are a son of God. You are taking territories. You are going in the might, in the power of the Spirit. You are driven by the Spirit and going in the name of Jesus. Yes. You take territories. Why? Because you have secured the presence of God. You have secured the government of God. Thou art with me. You are an ambassador of God. The rod and the staff. The word of God and the symbol of authority. The mantle that you are using. The baptism of the Holy Spirit. Hello, the scepter of righteousness. The scepter of righteousness. My God. Hey, Jesus, they bring comfort to our soul. He said, he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemy. Yes, every day you study from the word of God, you are eating. Amidst the tantrums of the devil, amidst the schemings of the devil, you find yourself eating. Wow. He prepares a table before me. The presence of my enemy. He anoints my head with oil. Yes, that's something we understand. That is the anointing of God, the impartation of godliness that hits our hearts, that gives us the power to manifest Jesus Christ. Basically, like I always say, there is always a transfer of virtue, there's a transfer of anointing when we devote ourselves to word study. If files can be transferred from device to device via Bluetooth, it's just to speak of the transfer of virtue from the region of higher concentration to the region of lower concentration. Hey, my God. That's what he's saying. He anoints my head with oil and my cup overflows. Yes. He says that out of us will flow rivers of living water. You see, this is coming from the World Bank that we have put on our inside. You will not deliver more than the level of word that you have stored on your inside. You will not deliver greater than the anointing that you have received when you have committed yourself to word study. The Bible says this book of the law must not depart from out of your mouth, but you meditate on it day and night and observe to do all that is written therein, including your parts that you have found out. He has caused you to find out. You see, and then thou shalt make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Incredible thing to note here, that God anoints our head so that we can have good success, so that our cup will run over. It's still your right. It's a right. It's a kingdom right for you. It says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow us. Follow me all the days of our lives, all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the presence of God. Yes, you have a right to have things of eternal significance follow you. Things of eternal significance. That's what good is. Goodness is anything that has eternal value. Yes, you have a right to live eternity in your trail. You have a right to have eternity stand up by the things that you do. You have a right to get the approval of God. Say, yeah, yes, yes, this is good with the things that you do. It will follow you all the days of your life. So it's your right to live in righteousness. It's your right. It's your right. It's actually your right. You can take up. You can take it up. You can endeavor to bring it about. You can endeavor to work it out by the help of the Holy Spirit. That's why you have the Holy Spirit. It's Him that is going to make sure that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Yes, that's exactly what it is. Then the mercies of God is incredible to note. That the mercy of God is what wants to make God talk to us. It's what wants to make God start a new slate. The Bible says the mercies of the Lord, they are new every day. Yes, the thing that wants to make God expect something better from you, better than the last that you did. That's what God actually wants to work through us in this hour. And He says it's Him that's at work in us, both to will and to do according to His good pleasure. There's so much that God is doing for us at this time, and we must apprehend this. You see, this kingdom right that we enjoy doesn't end on this part of eternity. It takes us out there into the world to come. It takes us across the charades of this epoch, on this particular dispensation, and it takes us to eternity. We secure the presence of God all the way. Oh my God. You must celebrate yourself. You must celebrate God. You must celebrate Jesus for doing this all-time great work in our lives. And this is what this gospel of the kingdom is saying. In all of it, the Holy Spirit is leading us to develop a new utopia on earth that will uphold the reign of Jesus and sustain the legacy that God has for man, the legacy of leadership, the legacy of having all these rights mingled in our experience and causing us to manifest Jesus. Yes, this is what the devil knows. And you see, the devil is actually trying to disrupt this plan. That's why he gave us democracy. I'll tell you something. I know this will bring people against me, but I will say it here. Democracy is actually preparing the world for the reign of the Antichrist. It will become clear to us very soon that the lawless one has stepped up his game over the last hundreds of years. The devil, he has inspired the generation to bring up this political thought that exposes man to the rule of self. A government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It doesn't talk about God in the government. There is no God in the government. So just the way when he first told me this in 2009, I was afraid. When he told me, and the Holy Spirit told me these things, and he told me democracy, be watchful, be wary of democracy, because the devil has given it to the world so that he can reign over it. Incredible. My God. So he told me that he gave this gospel of the kingdom to the world so that Jesus can reign over the world. So you see, it's an antithesis. Democracy is taking man to the reign of the devil, especially with systems that have promoted the things that you and I know that is anti-God, is anti-Christ. We have seen men marrying men. We have seen corruption everywhere. We have seen ignorance. Yes, instead of knowledge. Yes, we have seen a lot of things. We see that depreciation and inflation of money, it continues. We've seen all sort of rubbish, particularly promulgated and promoted and postulated by this democratic concept. And apart from that, the devil knows, instead of the Holy Bible that the gospel talks about as the constitution to govern the conduct of men, he gave us a human constitution, a people's constitution. Every democratic society has a people's constitution. And the people's constitution does not tell you the source of the law. It doesn't tell you the lawgiver. No, the people are the lawgiver. Does God want man to rule himself? Does our Father want man to rule himself when he has given us this gospel of the kingdom that promotes one hallmark, the global rulership of God? God doesn't want man to rule himself. Yes, he doesn't want man to rule himself. And it's an interesting thing to note that the devil has brought the constitution for us to govern our conduct. Yes, that's exactly what is happening. The second core belief system, instead of the reign of Jesus as a law that is fulfilled in all flesh, he has given us the rule of law. Democracy is about the rule of law. It's actually about the rule of the lawless one. Just communicated to us as the rule of law so that we will see it as something that we should go by. And lastly, you are seeing yourself go under laws. They want to call it human rights. Yes, it's actually the exchange. He was given an exchange of kingdom rights that we are supposed to enjoy. This is exactly how the devil has deceived an entire generation. Nations have come and have bought along. They have run along with the democratic thought. But I'm telling you, we'll be one of the first people that will begin to face the kinds of persecution that God told the church that the church will face. Democracy is preparing the world. It's clear for all to see. It's preparing the world for the reign of the Antichrist. And what's God saying? Turn back. Turn back. Come out of her. Come out of her. Come out of her. Come out of her. Is it going to make you a lawless person? I'd rather submit to the law of the kingdom than a law that tells man that he has provided a room for man to marry man. Yes, countries are coming to boycott democracy. And listen, it's already begun in America. It's begun in America, quietly. We are seeing some sort of narcissistic ruling by a democratically elected president. I'm not going to call names, but you understand what I'm saying. Democracy is not of God. And then let us end it there. And this brings me to the fourth definition of this gospel of the kingdom. And it's the literary definition. A very incredible revelation that God had taught us. And he communicated it to me in Matthew 24, verse 14a. Where he said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. The literary definition of this gospel of the kingdom speaks about a generation that will rise, that will deliver the same message, the same effect, the same ministry, the same miracles, the same mystery unraveling exploits. The same miracle working exploits that Jesus meted out during his earthly ministry. Now, I'll give you the key. You see, my God, Jesus explained something in the book of Luke when he was bringing to fulfillment Isaiah 61. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. So first and foremost, he's trying to tell us that when man fell from the place that God created him to stay, to be in Adam, man became poor. So he has defined poverty as something that is spiritual. The moment man separated himself from God, man became poor. And when he says the Spirit of the Lord has enabled him, he has anointed him, empowered him to preach the gospel to the poor. Incredible. Jesus preached the gospel. And you see, after he came, he preached the gospel, he practiced the kingdom of God, he taught about the kingdom of heaven, he used his parables, he used many technical ways to explain what he communicated back to man. He went to die. And on the third day, he rose again. And we saw some very interesting things that he did. He restored the kingdom of heaven. He went away and sent us the Holy Spirit to restore the kingdom of God. But you see, in all of this that Jesus Christ did, he sent us something. He sent us on a great commission. He sent us on an errand. He said, go into the world and preach the gospel. Now, let me define what the gospel is. The gospel, literally, by definition, is the record of the life of Jesus during his earthly ministry, as recorded in the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So, this is specifically what Jesus Christ said we should do in the Great Commission. All authority in the heavens and the earth has been given to me. So therefore, you go into the world and preach the gospel. What Jesus Christ said in earnest was, so therefore, you, I'm talking about Matthew 28, from verse 17 to 19. He said, so you, giving us the Great Commission, he said, we should go into the world and give the world our individual record of the life of Jesus during his earthly ministry. The church is actually Jesus Christ on repeat. The church is actually supposed to carry out the same work that Jesus Christ did. The church is actually supposed to do the same thing that Jesus did. The same miracles, the same works, the same Holy Spirit, the same Word of God, the same authority, the same awareness, the same consciousness. That's why Paul said we have the mind of Christ. That's why Paul said, I don't live by myself, I live by the faith of Jesus Christ. We're supposed to use the same faith that Jesus Christ used. It's an incredible expectation that God is having of us. And you see, if it's difficult, because before now, many people think Jesus is in the world of his own. If it's so difficult to talk about you, or us, or me, manifesting Jesus, God has given us a prophetic word about it. He said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. The message that he preached, Luke 4, verse 43, is the gospel of the kingdom of God. And when Jesus Christ was giving us what I want to call the biggest prophetic missile that has ever been shot by any man inspired of the Holy Spirit, he said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached. He said, a generation will rise that will live this God-inspired life, this Holy Spirit-enabled life, this eternal life in all the world. Yes, that's what he said. You do your part to be a part of this generation. You do your part to submit to the Holy Spirit. You do your part to study the word ceaselessly. You do your part to pray the prayers of Jesus. You do your part to fast. You do your part to wait on the Lord for empowerment. You do your part to receive mystery from God. You do your part to stay in righteousness and be holy and be ready. You do your part to stand as an ambassador of God. You do your part to expand and expound this kingdom of God mystery. You will do your part to advance the kingdom in all the world. You will do your part to influence the nation with the culture of Jesus. You do your part to be a part of this generation. The generation that will extend the ministry of Jesus to the world. The generation that will go into the world and do what is willing, do what is required in the world. The world is ripe for the kingdom. The world with systems and institutions is ripe for the government of God. It is time for us to go out and do this work that God has called us to do. Yes, we don't have to wait for any Bible school certificate. We don't have to wait for any ordination from any church system. The best empowerment we need, we have been given. We have been given the Holy Spirit to help us do this work. Depend on the Holy Spirit some more. Pray in the Spirit some more. Pray in your understanding some more. Test. Yes, if you are not thirsty, you won't be filled. You must be filled with the capacity, an increased capacity to mete out godliness. You must have your faith increased. You must increase your faith by word study. You must devote your time to learn how you want to engage God. You must devote your time to develop the sensitivity of Jesus. You must develop the mindset of Jesus. You must develop your full knowledge and understanding of your authority in Jesus. You must go out there and dispel the devil. You must go out there to put the ministry of Jesus on a repeat. You must go out there to preach the gospel. You must be inspired of the Holy Spirit. You must not despise the movings of the Holy Spirit on your inside. That's what you must do, Church of Jesus Christ. You must be able to be the one that will heal and mend the brokenhearted. When the world comes to you, the world should see that Jesus is revealed in you. It's not the time to be like Christ. This is not the time to be a Christian. This is time to be another manifestation of Jesus. This is time to give people the ministry of Jesus with your life. This is exactly what God wants of the church. We must open the eyes of many to look in the realms of the spirit and see that solution comes from there. Yes, we must take the yoke of the oppression of the devil from the shoulders of people that we come to meet. In all our doing, we must leave a trail, a Jesus Christ of Nazareth nostalgia in the lives of the people we encounter in our daily lives. Yes, in our daily circumstances, we must leave a nostalgic feeling in the lives of people. Let them look at us and say, Jesus must have been like this. Above all, you will bring fulfillment to the scripture that says you are the light of the world and the salt of the earth. The scripture that says you should go into the world and preach the gospel. You should go into the world and preach the gospel. The one that says that you should let your light so shine before men that they will see your good works and they will glorify your Father in heaven. This is what the acceptable year of the Lord's favor means. By your life, this eternal life that you are living, people will long for God. The thirst and taste for the ways of God will be increased in the hearts of people. And you will play your part in setting up the peoples of the world for an encounter with Jesus. Yes, the providential plan that God has always had is to bring man back to Him and ensure that His presence lives with man forever. If you look at it, you'll find that the world is ripe and ready to submit to the mind of God at this hour. It is my prayer that God in His infinite mercy will help His people. He will help His people understand this message. He will help His people come to terms with their own part of this message. By His Spirit, He will cause all flesh to find where it is written concerning them. We will find our role in the script for every creature, and we will safely bring the establishment of the kingdom of God with systems and institutions influencing the peoples of the world to make room for Jesus in their hearts, so that once again the earth shall be covered with the knowledge of God's glory. Once again, the angels will say, at last, the kingdoms of this world has become the kingdom of our God and of His Son. We thank You, dear Heavenly Father. We glorify Your name in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Yes, if I'm taking you through this gospel of the kingdom thought, I want to tell you congratulations. Yes, if you had stayed with me till now, yes, you deserve to be congratulated. I want you to subscribe to know more of this. Just wait on God by yourself. Go in a fast and ask Him what He wants you to do about what you are hearing. And He will answer you. because this is the time to bring fulfillment to scripture. The biggest thing that God is doing at this hour is to conscript people into this agenda. It's not about a church. It's not about a religion. This is not about Christianity. This is about the kingdom. This is about the kingdom. I'm encouraging you today. Seek first the kingdom. Place priority on the kingdom. And God will use you to deliver the greatest desire for all of humanity and the systems of the earth. My name is Odion Ipuga. I'm encouraging you again as I meditate for Destiny Incorporated. God bless you always. Amen.